do any energy that you use in space and power, I think there is some...
Okay, sorry.
So, that's it.
And...
Space Security Office did, where they talked about how incredibly expensive per kilowatt hour it is to produce power for deployed bases and so on and so forth. The Air Force likes the idea of coming up with something to dramatically reduce the logistical trail in terms of energy production. And Glenn has a lot of the technology to put together a test to do something like that. So there are, my understanding is there are talks between Glenn and their counterparts at DOE to do a test bed on the station.
That's wonderful news. I mean, I heard, in the past, I think people at Johnson were working on an in-space test using the station, but they were told that by Griffin to stop work on it, even though they were doing it on their own time.
Yeah, that's gone out the window. Now that station is being in town, we've been getting proposals to do exploration research and technology.
So, can I try to get any
awards? Okay.
There's at least two companies pursuing that very same thing here in the United States.
Sorry, thank you.
The one in California and the one that's heard that
solar.
So, is the federal money going into this?
What's the federal
money?
Power's out in the
Well,
we're still doing government research on the internal combustion engine, and powers that go. And the government is also now saying that they're not doing space solar power because it's not commercial. So
When NASA got in competition with the US with field commercial launch vehicles 10 years ago.
But I mean the power market is so huge that there's not going to be a killing off of any space or power company. The power market is very huge. And also the government is now saying that these companies are not commercial. So that would really hurt. They're saying space solar power is not commercial. That's the line, and you ask why the government is not doing space solar power. They say it's not commercial. I think
it's not commercial in what sense? It's not commercial.
Ask Dr. Chu. Ask Ron. That's what the government line is, that space solar power is not commercial. I think that's an incredibly rude thing to say when you have U.S. companies trying to raise money.
Yeah.
And contracts.
Commercial partners. So essentially, they've come up with a system where Glenn does some of the initial R&D and kind of proof of concept, and then they spin it off into something that a commercial company can mass produce. Like they're doing it with flywheel technology right now, also.
Right.
Which kind of rolls up into, okay, you trickle in space solar power, store it in a flywheel, and then beam it down at the appropriate energy density. That's one of the things that they're looking at.
And are they partnering up with it? The Solarand and the other companies.
I'm not sure.
Additional entrants as well.
I'm not sure.
Would be a good thing.
Yeah, I'm not sure who all they're partnering up with, but I know that they're essentially trying to get this kind of like trifecta where there's NASA involvement, industry involvement, and Air Force involvement, so that all three parties can go to their either investors or stakeholders, be it in the Pentagon or at the headquarters, and say, look, we've got these partners here. You can't screw us over, because then we're going to be letting our partners down, and we're trying to get a perfect storm going to roll out on this.
Yeah, but the other thing I want to say about the government saying it's not commercial, especially Bobby Braun, who had NASA New Technologies, is what is the point of the government in terms of technology? develop new technologies so they can become commercial. So if you're saying that there's this technology that's good except it's not commercial, that's exactly where the government should be acting. The real problem is based on car technology right now is there's too many good ways to do it. You know, it's like, we know we can do it, but it's like, what is the best frequency? What is the best kind of space solar power, solar cells? How do we construct these? There's just, what should it be, a LEO or MEO or GEO? There's just too much.
And there's not going to be a single solution because
right.
The mobile users like the DOD have one set of requirements, and the stationary users like African villages or whatever have a totally different set of requirements.
But
we
DOD
might end up with multiple.
Yeah, DOD needs a stationary too. They need to power the forward bases. Paying the equivalent of like $10 a kilowatt hour to power the bases and the forward bases. Yeah, to power forward bases. And
those bases don't move too much.
And yes, and the half the casualties in Iraq were fuel trucks.
Were what?
Were fuel trucks. Or combat
vehicles.
Yeah, half the casualties. We could cut the casualties in half with space over.
Wow. I mean, somebody needs to be shouting that one from the rooftop.
Yeah.
The National Space Security Office did that analysis where they looked at how much it costs per kilowatt hour to provide energy to their forward deployed bases.
Every media outlet needs to be screaming that one at the top of their lungs.
I don't understand how
that's going to work.
And that means you're not going to hear it.
About
you're not going to hear it.
Why you don't know that?
On the ground.
You need to find out
about microwave receivers.
That's true.
Possibly kilometers wide.
Well, it's easier, not that difficult to project a kilometer wide area of the desert that you already control the area of. But
is that how much would be needed for the power density, for the power density requirements or perhaps a couple of bases?
Well, the key is at the frequency that they have been proposing to use, kilometer. On the ground is necessary for the replicant. But it is just basically a net with some electronics attached. So it's, you could probably have lots of spares that you could easily deploy. It would be very difficult to take the whole kilometer thing out. The other thing is it would be relatively easy to protect versus, hundreds of kilometers of road.
Right, and you could certainly do that already on any of the air bases.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And you could just put it between the air, between the runways, and you don't have that much perimeter anyway.
Yeah, put it in no man's land.
Right, you need the runways.
Yeah.
The airplanes don't care too much. Okay.
How serious is the environmental? I assume your environmental groups oppose this. Is that correct?
The main.
If you could just talk about it.
The main opposition to space solar power, I think, is not in terms of the environmental effects of space solar power. There is some concern about heating the Earth from it and the safety of microwaves, which is something we need the government studies on because the commercial people can't do those government studies. But the main opposition, I think, is the attitude. There is two main worldviews. One is we all use less and we all lower our standard of living and we live within we live carbon free within the Earth's resources. And the other is we go out and build space solar power and everybody lives a middle class lifestyle on Earth. We move the other 6 billion people up to middle class lifestyle. And that seems to be the main division. There's a lot of people who really don't like the idea conserve. What we need to do is develop in a different way.
I was involved in the early first meetings with Sea Launch, the Bowman Sea Launch project, the Greenpeace was a major problem. The idea of just taking a ship and launching a rocket from the Christmas Islands in the Pacific was met with formidable opposition from Greenpeace.
Based on?
They didn't want a rocket launching from pristine ocean waters in the event of a failure, in the event of a catastrophic explosion, and they're just not happy with it. And Boeing ignored it. Boeing ignored it for about a year, and then finally when they realized that they put these ships in the launch area and stuff, they had to sit down with Greenpeace and came up with a solution. So I just have to believe that there is opposition from powerful environmental groups to burning a hole for.
Well, I don't think there is, because I don't think they've been paying enough attention to it.
But there might be.
But yeah, they shouldn't.
What was the solution the boy came up with?
I'm not privy to it. But I believe it had to do with A, modification to some launches, and B, I mean, I'll just say this, I'm not privy. I can probably begin paying for some of Greenpeace, make contributions to Greenpeace.
I think the answer to that is to find areas of common ground where you can demonstrate that space solar power helps them with their larger objectives. For example, cleanup effect.
Carbon
that,
footprint.
Yeah, you reduce your carbon footprint because you aren't burning petrochemicals to produce energy, or you're not burning coal to produce energy. There's also the fact that by maximizing the efficiency of your transmission by radiating on a wavelength that is largely atmospheric transparent, you reduce your, by increasing your efficiency, you actually reduce the amount of heat you introduce into the atmosphere. So the better you get the system to work, the less your environmental impact is to begin with. So that's kind of a win-win there. And it was like one of the founders of Greenpeace, he's actually now working with the nuclear industry as an advocate, because he said if he knew about global warming back in the 70s, he would have focused Greenpeace on fighting nuclear weapons, not fighting nuclear power at all. And so he's actually working with advocacy groups on the idea of developing thorium-based power systems, because thorium only emits alpha radiation, so you can handle it safely with standard personal protective equipment. It's fertile but not fissile, so you can't make nuclear weapons out of it, things like that, because he realized that carbon pollution is a bigger enemy to the environment than nuclear energy.
If you do it right.
If you do it right. And so if you can, and so I think if you can meet with the environmental lobby and the environmental groups and figure out where your common interests are and where your common strengths are, co-op them ahead of time instead of waiting for them to launch their salvo, and you head
be proactive.
Off. Right.
Yeah, the other thing about the environmentalists is there is a problem with the environmental community, in that there are groups that want to put solar power stations in for environmental reasons, but other groups who oppose it because it destroys the desert and will wipe out species, and wind power can damage raptors, and there's all sorts of trade-offs with these. And in space solar power, you don't destroy any desert, you just sort of put a net over it, and you know, may affect these species below, but you don't have to rip up their environments to actually.
So reaching out to that community ahead of time and making common cause with them would seem to be.
Yeah.
A good way to, a healthy way.
Yes,
to.
But the problem is maybe it will be different in energy, but my experience in aerospace is the last people aerospace folks want to talk to is environmental people.
Yeah, well,
they rather talk to the Russians, Chinese first before they talk to organized environmental group. Maybe it will be different in solar power.
If you do a cost-benefit analysis,
yeah.
I think your example earlier was one example. I think it's worth it to proactively
make a business case.
Well, sure. It's always better to talk.
You're wasting more money by waiting.
Yeah. But the aerospace community traditionally is right of center, a Republican, and has a tin ear for a lot of the consumer. They're not familiar. They're not trained. Lockheed, Boeing, Northrop Grumman. They're just not used to consumer marketplace and opinion in that
They
sense.
Need more marketing companies.
Yeah. I mean, they're used to the Pentagon as a customer. Sliding in here, their customer, and probably one of the whole fears of solar power, I'm guessing I don't know much about it, but is it's a new market, a diversified market. They have to learn to live with energy people, and then there's a whole different equation.
So where do folks from Solaron and the other one come from? Do they come from the aerospace community, or do they come from the energy community?
I think they come from the aerospace community.
Are they?
Not totally
so
sure.
they might have the same disease.
Yeah, but hopefully they're the ones who have jumped over the fence to freedom.
Back to the issue.
Yeah.
Is anybody having more to say on this? But back to the issue of policy. One thing, I'm not sure if people in this room are aware of, there was this open government initiative called the Open Government Idea Scale. And which took ideas on all across the government in like 20 different agencies. And the idea of an interagency space solar power conference was the top idea at NASA, OSTP, and DOE, and at NASA it was the most popular idea of the government as a whole. And none of these agencies have done anything about moving towards that direction. And so I wonder if there's actually some opposition, because I would think that it would be fairly easy to, you know, have a little conference about this size and proclaim that you're doing major stuff for open government and talking about space solar power. And I became really suspicious of whether there's actual opposition within the government when I heard recently a rumor that Buzz Aldrin has been invited on a trip to India with the president, but he was told that under no circumstances was he allowed to mention space solar power, which I was really shocked by, and I thought it was nearly a criminal thing, because there are only two technologies that can give India the power it needs to become a middle class, give everybody a middle class lifestyle, and that is nuclear and space solar power. I don't think if you put solar panels on every rooftop and every piece of vacant land in India that they could get reasonable amounts of power.
So who told them that you couldn't say?
Someone in the administration. Somebody high up in science policy.
Space
policy. Yeah, in presidential, in science. Possibly, or else in the office administration dealing with space policy. I don't know exactly who said that to him, this is all coming second and third hand. But I was really shocked because, I don't think the U.S. government would like India to be invest in a large scale nuclear development program, considering their issues with their amount of coastline. They should not do something that would be carbon producing. And India has a huge coastline, so they should be really concerned about global warming. So that basically leaves space solar power as the only technology to bring India up to middle-class standards. And, the U.S. government is shutting that down as a possibility to even talk about.
Maybe we're afraid that they're going to leapfrog us, that they're going to leap ahead. Because there's a lot of other countries out there that are on the bandwagon and are moving forward.
But
they're going to leave us behind.
Well, get out of neutral.
I don't want to depend on the government any longer. As an entrepreneur, I intend to do it on my own, with others like me.
I think doing it without the government is great, except my fear for Solarin, which actually has a contract to sell power, is what if they succeed and they build their space solar power satellite in the rectum and they start beaming down power, and one of their local neighbors gets a court injunction against them because the regulations involved in satellite transmission are totally inaccurate, or have very little to do with space solar power. They have to do with communication satellites.
I'll tell you what's going to happen. Entrepreneurs like me are going to go abroad and do it with foreign money.
It's hard to get foreign money when the largest government in the world is saying it cannot make money. There is that. But Solarin is right now trying to do it in California. And if they get shut down because of court injunctions, because the government has really not dealt with the issue, it would put space solar power back a long way. I mean, the company could go bankrupt fighting in courts trying to show that this is safe. Even if they funded studies, nobody trusts government, private corporation funding
they
studies.
Either, so.
Well, they don't really trust the government, but they trust the government studies more than they do
maybe another preemptive solution here is to follow the model that FAA is doing with ASD,
mm-hmm.
which is creating and chartering an office whose job is both to support the development of entrepreneurial space industry and at the same time regulate its safety vis-a-vis the uninvolved public.
Yeah, I think
the question is who's going to do that?
I think the Department of Commerce would be excellent at that, and especially the Office of space commercialization at the Department of Commerce would probably be excellent to take a lead on that. Also, Commerce has also the third largest world space agency, NOAA, and they deal with bandwidth also, so.
Well, but the issue here is going to be the impact of the antenna on the environment. That's probably DOE. No, that's EPA,
yeah.
Probably. And then the other one is the passage of microwave radiation through the atmosphere. Where does that belong as regulatory? I mean, FCC?
Yeah, well, I mean FCC deals with that. I mean, we have to get the FCC involved to get the bandwidth and the ITU to get bandwidth.
Well, FCC gets involved with microwave propagation from microwave weapons.
Yeah, but any bandwidth issue, the space the FCC takes the lead on or has to be involved in.
So, but that also means that there's both of these two agencies need to end up in a coordinated regulatory process,
right,
which is going to be a lot of fun.
Is FCC part of the Department of Commerce?
No.
No.
Were they in?
Are they independent
agency?
Yeah.
And EPA is interior?
EPA is an independent
is also
as well.
But there is a group in Commerce who deals with
bandwidth.
I'm not sure. I forget the name.
NTIA.
NTIA, yeah.
I think it's NTIA. It used to be NTIA.
Yeah.
I wonder if congressional leadership might bring the appropriate players together. For example, I'm from New Jersey. Mm-hmm. I happen to live in the district of Congressman Rush Holt, mm-hmm. Who I would think is exactly the right guy to talk to about this because he is the former assistant director of the Princeton Plasma Physics Laboratory.
Oh, wow.
A physicist by training, some huge. And a heck of a nice guy, actually. A concerted push to talk to his staff and to see if he can put that on the agenda of some of the committees that he's on. That would be a perfect example for somebody in Congress to pick this up as an issue for this year. And we had a really re-election campaign going on. If somebody starts talking about solving both the environmental issue and the hydrocarbon dependency, dependency on external oil as being related or being solved by this approach, that might make for a really hot-button election issue.
Well, I think he can get a lot more traction, too, if he relates it somehow to earthbound jobs.
Yeah. Oh, definitely.
Well, let's look at that. And back to Iraq.
Yeah, but also...
To the casualties of Iraq. I mean, that's an awesome election bond issue.
Also, but also the balance of payments issue.
Payments is another one. This is a plus across four things.
Is he a Democrat or Republican?
He's a
Democrat.
Okay. He's a pretty strong Obama Democrat, and has been for a while. So
is he up for re-election?
Yes, he is.
Yeah, all of them are. All of them represent.
So he's he clearly has the technical, gravitas to understand the issues and the solutions. And he's in a staunchly Democratic district, so he's really not going to be challenged that much, I don't think. But so that gives him a little bit of leeway to bring in issues. The only problem is that this hasn't been one of his core issues, and he's not. I have to check it out.
What committees is he
associated? I don't think he's on any of the committees that care. He might be on one of the Commerce subcommittees.
I'm from Houston, which is the heart of the petrochemical industry.
Houston.
And I've actually written about this idea for, I write an independent politics blog for the Houston Chronicle. And I talked about the all the area of what space solar power hits. And even in Houston, which is the heart of the petrochemical industry, I've gotten a lot of positive response because the petrochemical people, as far as they're concerned, we're still going to need oil for plastics, we're still going to need oil for industrial chemicals, and so on and so forth. And so if we reduce our dependence on foreign imports and we're buying more from domestic sources, that's good for them. They still get to keep their jobs, they're still happy with that. And we'll need advanced plastics, we'll need rocket fuel. actionable to launch all of this stuff up there. So as far as they're concerned, it's a win-win. It brings Pete's high-tech jobs here in the U.S. without directly competing with them. So.
Our highways are made out of petroleum products.
Yeah.
And they have to be rebuilt often. And we're building more and more roads. And so what are our highways going to be made out of in the future? When petroleum gets too expensive, so there's, well, but that uses even more carbon just to create, you know, limestone.
But that's,
so it's not a sustainable idea.
The roads are made out of very heavy distillates, not the light distillates.
But we can only recycle those so many times. And then we've got to figure out something else.
Yeah. There's probably
can I interrupt real quick? Ignite talks are about to start in 5 minutes. So I just wanted to warn you guys to be aware of the time.
Okay, thank
you. Okay. Caleb, you're good to stay here until somebody gets you. Okay?
I'm supposed to bring the computer.
Are you going to bring it back? Just stay here. Just
okay,
stay here.
I'm... Okay. Actually, there's a guy that's...
Can you comment on what some folks here mentioned that Dax is doing? Can you sort of comment, are you up to date on what's going on in the rest of the world?
Okay, well, the Japanese have committed $21 billion over the next, I forget how many years, a decade or more, to build a space solar power demonstration. The European company is also looking into space solar power. The Russians are interested in space solar power. Dr. Kalam, former president of India, is very interested in space solar power, which is one of the reasons why it is disturbing that space solar power seems to be off the table in terms of the president's visit to India. So I might be forgetting somebody, but...
I know China is also interested because their pollution problems...
They've been working a lot with the space energy people. That's not an American company, but it might have an office in California purposes be an American company. I think it does have an office in California. But space energy has been made 2 trips in the last few months to talking to the Chinese about space solar power. Two big conferences where they were involved. So there's a lot going on under the it's like we may get run up, the US government may have a Pearl Harbor situation with space solar power and that. Finding everybody and his dog having a space solar power demonstration or actually as a project, and we're doing nothing.
So I think what you're suggesting is talking to people in Congress, getting a bug in their ear.
I'm writing notes exactly what I'm going to tell their staff.
Yeah, but I'm thinking maybe that's the takeaway from this is that we those of us that have been in the soft, we go out and we talk to our friends and allies back at our respective homes, and get them to start talking to their Congress people about how this is important, what opportunities that it offers, linked to the various studies that have been done. I know there was a study that ESA did a couple of years ago that showed that a space-based solar power system would pay for its energy costs to establish within 1 year of operation.
So if you guys can help me, I took the notes after the conversation went on. Here's what I have. Reduce carbon footprint, reduce foreign oil consumption, improve balance of trade, help reduce casualties in the future for armed conflicts, jobs.
Yeah.
What else? What am I missing? What else am I bringing to the table?
Well, I think we need to figure out whether we're going to be leaders or followers.
That's
and right now, we're looking like followers.
That's going to be hard as an election issue to a
first off, you're not going to raise any election issue. I mean, go out and do what you want to do, but it's too late to raise an election issue in 6 weeks.
It might be.
Nonetheless,
the United States has always been seen as a leader, and we're falling behind. We're getting fat and lazy.
Well, you look at all the rhetoric in Congress right now over the space program in general,
right.
And that's the drum that everybody's beating, is that the U.S. still needs to be a leader.
I personally don't care if the government helps me. I just don't want them to get my way.
Right.
But as long as space is a jobs program, they are going to get in the way of actual space development. because.
Yeah, like one of the things I have to deal with is ICOM, mm-hmm. you know, the State Department at ICOM. I mean, I'm limited as to how I can gather people together and who I can talk to about whatever because of this regulation. And it's not like I want to take over the world. I just want to bring it together. Mm-hmm. So I just think
it's government. It's the bane of everybody's existence. We all have to deal with it.
But I think one issue is to say, do we want to be buying power from the Japanese or selling it to the Arabs in 50 years?
Right.
Or 20.
If the Arabs were smart, they get into space energy,
the space energy guy. One of the space energy guys has spent months in Dubai.
Mm-hmm.
Dubai is interested.
Well, I mean, who was it that made a large investment into Virgin Galactic?
It was a Middle Eastern guy.
Large bought 30% of Virgin Galactic, which may not be a direct investment, but it is in the same direction.
Is that Adama?
Yeah.
Yeah, they want to enter space hard. Well, thank you.
Thanks.
What was that? Ignite?
What?
Was that an Ignite talk?
No.
Oh, I don't know what I'm doing.
Well, no one does, as your father.
I'm not going to be a killing of any space or power company. The power market is very huge. And also, the government is now saying that these companies are not commercial. So that would really hurt. They're saying space solar power is not commercial. That's the line when you ask why the government is not doing space solar power. They say it's not commercial. I think
it's not commercial in what sense? It's not commercial.
Ask them. Ask Dr. Chu. Ask Father John. That's what the government line is, that space solar power is not commercial. I think that's an incredibly rude thing to doing it on their own time.
Yeah, that's gone out the window. Now that stations are being made in town, we've been getting proposals to do exploration research and technology and development and proposals. Maybe that's
so, can I try to get any words?
Okay.
There's at least two companies. They're pursuing that very same thing here in the United States.
Sorry. Thank you.
The one in California is the one that's heard that.
Solar.
So if there's part of the money going into this.
What's the second one?
Power
sets produce power from deployed bases and so on and so forth. The Air Force likes the idea of coming up with something to dramatically reduce the logistical trail in terms of energy production. And Glenn has a lot of the technology to put together a test to do something like that. And so there are, my understanding is there are talks between Glenn and the Air Force and their counterparts at DOE to do a test bed on the station.
That's wonderful news. I heard, in the past, I think people at Johnson were working on a in-space test using the station, but they were told by Griffin to stop work on it, even though
That sounds right. Is there private money going into this? Do you have government money going into
this? Well, we're still doing government research on internal combustion engine and power set. And the government is also now saying that they're not doing space solar power because it's not commercial. So
that's a good deal. When NASA got in competition with PLS with killed commercial launch vehicles 10 years ago.
But the power market is so huge that there's not going to be any energy that should be doing space solar power.
I think there is some.
Okay, sorry.
So that's it.
And
we've been hearing from our counterparts at Glenn that they have serious interest from the Air Force. Doing a space power beaming test that would initially be from, say, a platform on the station to a Falcon sat or something like that. It wouldn't necessarily be from space to ground at first, but it could be scalable to that. Because apparently, because of the studies that the National Space Security Office did, where they talked about how incredibly expensive per kilowatt.